I'm driving to a Tesla Supercharger in a Hyundai. I can do that because a ton of automakers, including Hyundai, have switched over to the North American Charging Standard port, or NACS, better known as the Tesla plug. But even with an NACS port, using a Tesla Supercharger in a car that doesn't have that T badge on the hood may be a little less simple than you might hope. We're gonna take this thing to a few different kinds of superchargers to find out everything you need to know.
Before we get there, some background. There are two main types of charge ports for EVs in the US, the Tesla-developed NACS system and CCS, which for the past decade has been the default for all non-Tesla vehicles. There are advantages to each. With NACS at a Tesla supercharger, the cable you use to plug into your car is smaller and lighter than at a CCS station. Plus, superchargers have historically been more available and reliable than CCS chargers. Cars with a CCS port can charge at a wide number of stations and aren't limited by manufacturer. But that requires the stations to actually work, and we've encountered tons of CCS stations that are broken, vandalized, or just straight up not working. So why are so many companies switching to NACS? Simple. People are more likely to buy an EV if they're confident they'll be able to charge the thing easily, and the supercharger network delivers that confidence.
There's a supercharger station right by Edmunds HQ. Let's head there first. If driving around looking for places to charge your non-Tesla EV sounds like your idea of a good time, and you want one of your own, you can get an instant offer on your car and check out new car listings on our site. I was worried this might happen. So now we know, even if your car has an NACS plug, but it's a non-Tesla, you can't necessarily charge at every supercharger station you see at the side of the road. It's not quite as easy as seeing a random one, pulling over, and plugging in to charge. So how do you know where you can charge? Well, if you have an official CCS adapter like this guy, ideally from your automaker so your car doesn't, you know, catch fire, you can charge at any CCS station, including Electrify America, EVgo, or ChargePoint. For NACS stations, the first option is to use the Tesla app. More on that in a second. At least for some vehicles, you can also use the car's built-in navigation system, should it have one, to route yourself to a supercharger station that accepts non-Tesla vehicles. But what if you'd rather use Apple CarPlay or Android Auto for your navigation? Well, Google Maps does have a feature that allows you to add your vehicle and search for NACS stations that accept non-Tesla EVs. Or you can use an app like PlugShare to filter by non-Tesla EVs and route yourself to a supercharger station that way. All right, we've found a supercharger that I've confirmed will work with our Ioniq 5 here. Let's go. This is a V3 supercharger station, the most common type you'll find. But if you don't have a Tesla vehicle, you might run into some problems as these were designed for Teslas and Teslas only, all of which have their charging port on the driver's side rear taillight. Because of the way these parking spots are set up and how short these cables are, they're not gonna reach everywhere. So this right here is the charging station for this parking spot. So let's see if it'll reach. Absolutely no way. So, what are we gonna do? We have to use this charging station, but the thing is, this station is for this spot, which is now empty, which effectively means that I'm taking up two charging spots just to charge my one Ioniq 5 because these cables are so short. As you can see here, this supercharger station doesn't actually have an option to pay with a physical card. There's no tap, there's no swipe. It's not quite that simple. So, how are you gonna pay? You're gonna download the Tesla app, give them your credit card information, and pay via that app every time you wanna charge here.
But for this car, Hyundai does actually have a system that allows you to pay from directly within the vehicle, thanks to the company's BlueLink app. It works with superchargers as well as other charging stations. Some other automakers, like Rivian, have added plug-in charge capability, which just means that when you plug in your vehicle, the car and the charger automatically communicate about your payment information. So if you like easy and convenient, definitely check out EVs that have that functionality.
Once you're all set up in the app, it's pretty easy. You just plug in and boom. Charging speed, though, is a bit of a different story. These V3 superchargers can charge at a maximum rate of 250 kilowatts, but the fastest cars we've tested can charge at speeds in excess of 300 kilowatts, so you might be losing out on a little bit of juice here. So, V3s are good, but they're not perfect if you like parking normally. But there's a better option.
There's a very limited number of V4 superchargers around the country. The first one only opened in October of 2023, but more are on the way. These are the ones you want, and that's where we're headed.
All right, we're here at the V4s. Power is humming away, and we've even got a couple little Ioniq 5 friends joining us here at this station. Now, the first thing you're gonna notice here is the parking.
it's a lot easier. I don't have to park across spaces or take up multiple chargers. And that's because these charging cables are significantly longer here at the V4s. Compared to the V3s, they're about 50 inches or more than 4 feet longer. We measured to check. That makes a huge difference, and it means that, with a few exceptions, no matter where your car's charge port is, you shouldn't have a problem. The other big difference at these chargers is charging speed. Unlike the V3s, these have a max charge rate of up to 325 kilowatts. Currently, the only Tesla product that can take advantage of that is the Cybertruck, but plenty of other EVs, including this Ioniq 5 here, should be able to charge faster at these stations versus the other ones. So if you can find a V4 station, this is definitely the way to go. We've got easier parking thanks to those longer cables, and depending on your EV, your car may charge even faster here than it will at other superchargers.
Okay, what does all this mean if you're actually buying an EV? First off, if you can get an EV with supercharger compatibility, do it. Access to more chargers is always better, even if they're not perfect, and you'll have to check to make sure that you can charge at that location. Second, you'll want to carry an official adapter whether your car has an NACS port or not. Remember, cars with an NACS port can still charge at CCS stations, and a lot of EVs with a CCS port can still charge at a supercharger, even if they're a couple years old. Port location is actually more important than port type. Most superchargers you'll find will have that shorter cable and potentially a less than ideal parking situation that'll force you to get a bit creative. So, what EVs do we recommend? All the details are on our site, but if you want an affordable sports sedan, the Tesla Model 3 is hard to beat. Not everyone loves their style, but Tesla built an incredibly refined, long-range, tech-forward EV for around 45 grand that ticks nearly all the boxes, as long as that whole everything through the touchscreen thing doesn't bother you. Plus, it can charge at every supercharger and even CCS chargers with an adapter. For an SUV around the same price, you could always go Model Y, but we really like the Hyundai Ioniq 5. You get a comfortable, quiet interior, fast charging, and much more user-friendly controls, although cargo space is a little tight. This one, as we know, has an NACS port for 2025, but earlier models can still use superchargers with an adapter. If you want a three-row, the Kia EV9 has similar strengths. Luxury sedan enjoyers should steer toward the BMW i5. Quality materials, a comfortable ride, and great driving dynamics make the BMW stand out. This one can't charge at a supercharger just yet, but BMW has said compatibility will arrive by the end of 2025 via an adapter for older i5s and through an NACS port in the future. And for a luxury SUV, we love the BMW iX, which will have the same supercharger compatibility as the i5, but we also recommend the Rivian R1S. The boxy three-row is ready for adventures away from pavement, but it's still comfortable and composed on road, and interior quality is excellent, especially on newer models. These work at superchargers as long as you have an adapter, but NACS-equipped versions of the R1T and R1S are coming for the 2026 model year. And that's all you need to know. What do you think? Would you avoid the headache of finding the right charger and hoping you can park semi-normally? Is there somehow a working V4 supercharger in your neighborhood? Should I trade in my old Macan GTS for an Ioniq 5, which I absolutely will not be doing? Let us know in the comments. I like to read them while I roll out of bed in the morning. See you next time.